I'm going to show you how I installed a mini split air conditioner from start to finish. I did a lot of research and watched a lot of videos before undertaking this project, and I hope this video will answer a lot of questions that I was unable to find answers for online. Please note that I am not an HVAC professional. This video is for entertainment purposes only. As you can see, the system arrived in two separate boxes delivered by FedEx. I'm installing the unit in a second story bedroom, and the condensing unit will be mounted on a wall outside the bedroom. I had to purchase the mounting bracket separately. Before I got started, I unpackaged the indoor and outdoor units to inspect and make sure there was no damage. Deciding where to mount the indoor and outdoor units will ultimately determine how difficult your installation will be. The installation manual will typically provide some minimum considerations. It is important to note the required clearances in order to allow the unit to operate efficiently. For my installation, I chose this wall because of the ease of access to the electrical outlet and also because the compressor could be located directly on the exterior side of the wall. Because the system runs on 110 volts and came plug-in ready, I only needed to relocate a new outlet behind the indoor unit. The indoor mounting bracket comes attached to the indoor unit. The bracket is held in place by two plastic tabs. Gently push on the plastic tabs as shown, and the mounting bracket will lift off easily. This unit came with screws and anchors for mounting the bracket into the drywall. In my case, I was able to mount the bracket directly to the studs on both sides. Mark for level and secure the bracket to the wall. On the back of the unit, measure the distance from the bottom and the sides where the refrigerant lines and the electrical wires exit the unit. The unit has a little more than an inch of side-to-side play on the bracket. I've transferred those measurements to the wall in order to ensure that the through-the-wall holes remain hidden behind the unit. The double-crossed area shown here represents the space behind the unit that should always be open regardless of how it is hung on the bracket. For the new outlet, I picked up a remodeling junction box from Lowe's. Using the box as a template, I marked the wall where I wanted to cut the hole. I taped this box to the wall to catch the drywall debris to save myself some cleanup time later. You can use a keyhole saw or a really sharp knife to make the hole, but I found this oscillating tool from Harbor Freight does the quickest and neatest job. When you're finished cutting, check the hole to make sure the junction box fits. Before you start working on the wires, make sure the electrical is turned off at the breaker box. A voltage tester like this is a great tool to have to make sure you don't get electrocuted. I purchased some Romex 14 gauge wire to run up to the new outlet. I used fish tape to make easy work of running the wires through the wall. I pulled the existing outlet out of the wall to gain access to the wires and the hole. Run the fish tape through the wall from top to bottom, connect the wires at the bottom, and pull the new wire up through the top hole. Attach the wire to the top outlet and the bottom outlet, connecting black to black, white to white, and ground to ground. Drilling the hole for the refrigerant lines is probably the scariest task of this project. The instruction manual did not specify the size of the hole to be used, so I just used a standard doorknob hole saw I had in my toolbox. Make sure to drill at a downward angle to ensure the drain line flows away from the unit. Remove the inside cover of the indoor unit. This is done by pushing slightly outward on the hinge arms until the pin is released. This device shows the digital readout on the front cover. It is easily removed by the two small screws, but is not necessary to get to the electrical connections. This cover houses the terminal block and is removed by the two small screws shown. Loosen the terminal block by removing this screw in order to gain access to the connection points. This plastic wire clamp should be removed in order to make installation easier. Terminal connections are labeled 1, 2, 3, N, and the grounding symbol. The wire colors don't necessarily match up, so be sure to use the indoor wiring diagram when making your electrical connections. Once you've secured the connections, feed the wire through the machine and out the back side. Fasten down the terminal block and the wire holding clamp. Finally, return the plastic cover and you've completed the indoor electrical connections. Slowly bend the copper wires to the angle that will allow them to be fed through the wall. In my case, the larger copper tube only extended 10 inches away from the back of the unit. Because the distance from the inside of the wall to the outside of the wall was also 10 inches, I was not going to be able to make this connection on the outside. I ran the larger copper pipe from the outside to the inside in order to make this connection. I cut 1.5-inch PVC pipe to the length of 10.5 inches to use as a conduit through the wall. Pull and bend the copper tubes together until the flange sits without any additional twisting. Securely fasten the copper pipes using a wrench at both ends. After wrapping the copper tubes, the electrical wires, and the drain line in the vinyl tape provided, I slid the PVC conduit pipe down. Slowly feed the tubes and wires through the wall. Take extra care not to kink the copper tubing. It might be easier if you have someone on the outside to help you, but I managed to do it by myself with little difficulty. Here's the indoor unit fully installed. As you can see, the through-the-wall hole and the electrical outlet are fully hidden by the unit itself. Although my application didn't require it, here's a picture of the cutouts if you need to run the tubes and wires out the side of the unit. Mounting the outside unit on the wall is fairly straightforward. I assembled the brackets and firmly attached them to the outside wall. Measure the distance between the feet on the condenser unit and make sure the brackets are appropriately spaced. Here you can see where the pipes and wires exited the wall. I located the condenser slightly down the roof pitch in order to avoid visibility from the front yard. Attach the rubber feet to the bottom of the condenser. I had two sets, one that came with the condenser and one that came with the brackets. I only used the set that came with the condenser. Place the condenser on the brackets and secure firmly with the nuts and bolts supplied. You can see here where I secured the second copper line on the outside. Separate the drain line from all the remaining items and wrap in vinyl tape. Slowly bend the copper wires towards the condenser unit, again being cautious not to kink the copper lines. Pop in the plastic drain tube on the bottom of the condenser unit. To remove the electrical panel cover, unfasten this screw and push down on the cover once the screw is removed to disengage the plastic clips. Similar to the inside electrical connections, the outside connections are also labeled with 1, 2, 3, and N. The ground is not labeled, but it is this screw that is attached to the metal housing of the condenser. In this picture, I've already removed the plastic wire clamp, but it was held in place by a screw here. As with the inside electrical connections, refer to the outdoor wiring diagram to determine the location of each of the colored wires. Here are my wires, all properly connected. Fasten the plastic clamp to hold the wires in place. Return the plastic cover and you are finished with the electrical connections. Remove the plastic cover housing the refrigerant valves. Unfasten this screw and pull up on the housing to remove it. After aligning each flange with the appropriate valve, secure the copper lines using one wrench to hold the valve and the other wrench to secure down the nut. A torque wrench could be used for this purpose. However, the instruction manual provided the appropriate stress in terms of wrist strength and arm strength. Once the copper tubes are secured, installation of the mini split is complete. The only remaining tasks are to bleed the line of air and humidity and to open the valves to allow the refrigerant into the system. In order to bleed the system, you're going to need three specialized tools. The first is a vacuum pump. Nothing fancy here. I picked this one up off of Amazon for about 50 bucks. Next, you're going to need a manifold gauge to be able to monitor the vacuum pressure in the lines. I picked this one up off of Amazon as well for about 30 bucks. It can get a little confusing with all the different types of refrigerant these gauges can measure. But since we're only bleeding a line, you can buy the cheapest one so long as it measures vacuum pressure. Finally, you're going to need this adapter, which allows the manifold gauges to be connected to the mini split service port. I picked this up off of Amazon as well for about $15. With my new tools in hand, I started by unscrewing and removing the cap from the service port. Next, I attached the adapter to the service port. Attach the blue line to the adapter. Attach the other end of the blue line to the blue manifold gauge. Note here how the blue manifold gauge has readings for vacuum pressure. Go ahead and open the blue valve. Attach the yellow line to the center connector of the manifold gauges. Attach the other end of the yellow line to the vacuum pump. For this application, there's no need to worry about the red line. Once all the lines have been connected, go ahead and turn on the vacuum pump. Here you will see the gauge dial has moved into the green area, which measures vacuum. The instruction manual suggests you leave the vacuum running for approximately 15 minutes. I went and had lunch and came back a half hour later. After the pump has run for a while, close the blue valve and then turn off the vacuum pump. When the valve is closed, the pressure reading should remain the same even after the vacuum is turned off. If the pressure drops on the dial after the valve is closed and the vacuum is turned off, it means you have a leak in your system. You'll need to go back, check all your copper tube connections, make adjustments as necessary, and repeat this process. I left everything alone for about an hour, and when I returned, the needle on the gauge hadn't moved, so I knew I didn't have any leaks. Remove the adapter at the service port. Replace and tighten the cap on the service port. Remove the caps from each of the two valves. Here you can see the inside of the valve, which in my case requires a 5mm Allen wrench. Turn each of the valves counterclockwise as far as they will go in order to fully open both of the valves. Spray all the connections with soapy water to check for leaks one last time. Replace and tighten the caps on each of the valves. Reinstall the plastic valve cover. Installation is now fully complete. Caulk or fill the hole with insulating foam where the wires and tubes exit the wall. And finally, check the unit for proper operation.